All right, time for quiz number three. As you notice right off the bat here, we're going to head backwards again to some places where we've had some issues, but we're going to get there. So when I get to this first one, I'm going to need to multiply through by the LCD because, again, we're avoiding the decimals at this point. Avoid the decimals. Showing work. That's how we can do this. I'd like to multiply through by the LCD, which in this case, if I were to count by 2s, 3s, 4s, and 6s, put them in a list, would be 12. But I know some of you aren't there yet. So, if you're not there yet, you can go ahead at this point and just multiply all of your denominators together, which would give you 144. Now, that's going to make it a little bit trickier to do this other stuff. We're going to need a calculator, I'd assume, but that's okay. So what we're going to do when we do this part is we're going to distribute that 144 to the numerators. It doesn't mean we're going to ignore the denominator. So for instance here, 144 times 7, if you put it in your calculators, 1008, and then you divide that by 4, would give me 252x. If I'm doing this right, the fractions are disappearing. So then I do it again. 144 divided by 3 is 48. And as I continue to do these, I just got to keep reminding myself, let's multiply times the top, divide by the bottom. So 144 times 5 is 720, divided by 2 is where the 360s come. I got to watch my signs too. And then finally I get here to the end. Now again, don't be frightened if you get a fraction for an answer. That's life, okay? First job, get all the X's together. I notice they're on opposite sides of the equals, so I have to do an opposite to get them together. So get that out of there. All right, let's see here. Whew, big numbers rolling here. But again, don't let that freak you out. It's not a big deal. Want to next isolate my x term. Let's see here. Okay. Now, my last job, and again, be careful with this. I want to get x by itself, so I need to divide by what's with x. And if you get a decimal out here, and you're going to, take a minute and hit math, enter, enter, or hit your fraction button on your calculator and get it reduced down to its simplest form. We're avoiding the decimals at this point. Not dealing with them anymore because we need to be able to prepare for this moving ahead. All right, then for our next two, our other arch nemesis, okay, these expressions. Remember on what I've said to you before. Look to see what it is you're trying to get a loan. And then we got to do opposites to get the other stuff out of there. So what's the furthest away from B on this side? Well, I'm dividing it by 4x. What's the opposite of dividing something? Multiplying. And whatever I do to one side, I have to do to both. On the right, it's just going to cancel out the 4x. And again, it's multiplying on the left. It's not 4x plus y. Okay, we've got to do the opposites of operations. And now it's actually going to be easy. I'm trying to get B alone. What's there with it? A minus and 3a. What's the opposite of that? Plus 3a. This is the kind of talk you have to be able to do with yourself, though, because if you're just copying this down for the first time right now, you're going, oh, that makes sense. If this is the last time you look at it or do one before the quiz, I will guarantee you're going to forget and you're going to put strange things down. B is by itself, I'm a happy camper. Now, one similar to that is this last one here. I'm solving for P. You're like, Harty, there's two P's here. Okay? I can't have P in the answer, so I can't just do something like add P, divide by MP, I'm good. No. Since both of my P terms are on the same side of the equals, I can pull a P out. You're like, oh, it's this again. What do I times P by to get the first term? Well, I've already got the P, but I don't have the 4M. What do I multiply P by to get to negative P? Well, I've got the P, but I need the negative 1 to hold the place. And now the variable that I'm trying to solve for, the P, there's only one, that's good news. And it's being multiplied, that's what you have parentheses next to something, that means multiply. So what's the opposite going to be? divide by that. And I can't say it enough. I said it on the last one. I'm going to say it again here. If this is an area where you struggle, I hope you've been working on some of these. You can ask me. I have a worksheet that's got some more of these on it if you need some practice. But if you don't practice them, it doesn't get better. Okay? So a couple of those will be on the quiz. Now we get to the stuff that we've actually been dealing with here lately. So identify the vertex, the slope, domain and range. Talk about that a little bit. And graph the following. So I look at this and I go, okay, vertex, reminders, write down your shift, that'll help you. So here, there's nothing in there, but this one's outside. So I'm going to go up 7, which means my vertex is that point I just plotted. Move this up a little more so my whole graph's on here. So here, my vertex is at 0, 7. To graph the rest of it, because again, my slope, my a value is negative 3 over 1, which tells me my graph is going to open downward, but remember, this isn't true slope. It's like air quote slope. So I'm going to go down 3 and over 1, but I got to do it both directions. And I'm going to do it a couple of times. Whoops. Hardy, hardy, hardy. To get my graph done. And then I'm using this domain and range as a review of what we've done before with this. So let's think about it for a second. My domain, remember what domain is? It's my x values from left to right. I got an arrow going forever to the left. I got an arrow going forever to the right. So my domain's negative infinity to infinity. My range, now, it does go down forever. So I'm with you on the negative infinity part, but it doesn't go up forever. It only goes up until I get to here, which is, what's my y value here? 6, 7. And I've got my range. Okay? Lots of things going on here, but again, just take your time and think back to how this all works. Okay, number 5, same deal going. I got 2 shifts this time, 2 transformations. Remember, what's inside the absolute value, it's the opposite of what you think. So you would think that plus 2 would be right 2, but it isn't. It's left 2. Always my left and right on the inside of the absolute value. And then whatever's on the outside is true to form, and that's going to be down 3. So left, right in here, up, down, out here. Okay, and you've got the note sheets again we did over a couple of days. You can look back at those if you need a little extra thinking of it. So move this up a little. So left 2, down 3. If I can remember how to count. Left 2, down 3. Okay, I got my vertex. No value in front of my absolute value. So what value is there? 1. So my slope's 1 over 1, which means it's going to open up. 1 over 1, again, both directions. We're shooting for a V-shape here. We don't just want lines. That's linear. That's not what we're looking for here. My domain, and you're going to see a pattern develop here. Forever left. Forever right. I wonder if that's going to be the case every time. I wonder. Range. Up forever. And again, it's bottom to top. So remember, with range, y values, bottom to top. And the order matters. If you flip it, that's off some. So you'd lose a point or so. So my range, where does it go at the lowest? Well, here's my lowest point. And it looks like that's where y is negative 3. And I'm set. It's a process, but again, all the pieces come together if you just know some of the basic knowledge of what's going on. Keep swinging over here. One more. All right, vertex. Should be quiet. Hit pause here and make y'all think about this for a second. Hopefully I remember that. If I don't, well, you're going to hear this quick. Opposite of what I think here, opposite of negative 3 would be positive, which would make me think right. So that minus 3 means I'm going right 3. Minus 1 means I'm going down 1. right, three, and down one. They all mesh together. So again, once I have that, look for my A. My A value this time is 2/3, which means it's opening up. So up 2 and over 3, up 2 and over 3, 3. And I bet you'll never be able to guess what the domain of this is going to be. That's right, how did you know? Negative infinity to infinity. Should be the easiest question on here. My range, again, goes up forever. So arrows up gets me a positive range infinity. Arrow down gets me a negative. But where do I start? Look at the y value. Negative 1. And I'm good. Okay? So that's our good solid review here of absolute value functions. So on to our next function that we played with. Piecewise. Evaluate. Find the answer. Again, the keys are... here, that's my restrictions, and here, that tells me what the x value is that I'm using. So, if I plug in 1 to each of these, it's only going to work in one of them. Is 1 less than 1? Not last time I checked. Well, you're like, but 1 isn't greater than 1 either, which is true, but 1 is equal to 1. So I slide over to what's here, and basically... I'm going to plug in the value. Now, notice I have to be careful here because I'm just plugging into the x value. Okay? Not changing the negative. Negative 1 minus 3 is negative 4. And I'm good. Negative 2/3. Is negative 2/3 less than 1? Last time I checked, a negative number is less than a positive. You're like, ooh, this is going to be ugly. Well, that's okay. So 2/3 times negative 2/3. Plus 2. You're like, okay, how am I going to deal with this? I don't know what to do. You know, what should I do here? Okay. Let me try to find a place where there's not going to be a lot of glare here. We can get some help. That's not a bad thing. So again, with these, I can use my fraction button here. Okay, my divide is my fraction button. Multiply that by negative 2/3. So that takes care of this part. And then plus 2. Now again, I don't want 1.555555555. No. Math, enter. 14 over 9. That's okay. And if you can do that without a calculator, even more power to you. But if it starts with a fraction, we're going to end it in a fraction here. All right, last one. I got to swing back over here so I can see what's going on. So 4. Is 4 less than 1? No. Is 4 greater than 1? Yes. Plug the 4 in. Negative 4 minus 3. Oh, is off the screen. Negative 7. All right. So we got you set with that as well. So then, let's take a peek inside here. Again, this is online as well, so if you need some stuff with that, that's good. All right, it's color time. All right. Okay. Things to remember. Start lines here. Don't start them at the y-intercept. Don't start them where you want to. Start them at x equals 2. So both of these lines are going to start somewhere on this line. So you're like, okay, well, how do I figure out the other part? Good question. Okay. I start at 2. Is it going to be an open or a closed circle at my starting point? How do you know? You're equal to, it's going to be closed. Okay. The fact that x is less than, and you've got to know this at this point. If the x is having the arrow point at it, it's less than. Less than goes left. What does that mean to you on your points? If I start at 2, and I start going left, 1, 0. Those are the other 2 points I'm going to use. And then I plug these in here. So negative 2 times 2 would be negative 4 plus 4 is 0. That would be negative 2 times 1 is negative 2 plus 4 is 2. And 0 plus 4 is 4. So when I go to graph, okay, first point's the one I make big. So 2, 0, big, colored in dot. 1, 2, 0, 4. And start from the big point. Connect the dots. It's going left, just like it's supposed to. That's what I'm talking about. I get down to here. And again, I've got a key in front. Or you can check me out later if somewhere I go a little quick, but I want to make sure we get all this in. Start at 2. Open or close circle. There's no line under there. It's going to be open. So now what do I do? Well, if I start at 2 and it's greater than X is being eaten by the arrow, that means I'm going to the right. So if I'm going to the right starting at 2, my next numbers are 3 and 4. So once I get those set, plug them in. If I got to go to the calculator, it's fine. Half of 2 is 1, so this would be negative 1 minus 2. It's negative 3. Try and deepen that up here. Okay. The 3, you're probably going to need some help. So that would be negative 3 halves, or negative 1 and a half, minus 2. It's negative 3 and a half. If you put negative 3.5, you know, you're just graphing it. That's fine. And then half of 4 is 2, so negative 2 minus 2 is negative 4. So, I go back and I do my thing again. I go to 2, negative 3, open circle, 3, negative 3 and a half, it's about here, and 4, negative 4, it's down here. Going to the right. Awesome. I got this. Okay, we're getting there. It's taking a little time, but we're getting there. All right, one more of these. We're going to zip through this one a little quicker because I think we got the gist of this now. At least we should at this point. We don't need to be talking to me. All right, where do the lines start this time? Better have said 1. You didn't say 1, I'll find you. All right, so starts at 1. Close dot. Less than goes left. Be able to ask yourself these questions when you're doing the quiz yourself, because I'm not going to be talking during your quiz. That'd be rude. 1 plus 1 is 2. 1, 0. And again, part of this, as I fill in my dot here and get going with it, is the reason I give you guys the quiz previews. Okay, not just the day before we go over it, but before then, so you can actually try some of this out and not just be trying to copy like a crazy person when I'm doing this. Now this second one, I'm going to slow down a bit because we have a twist. Start at 1, open. Greater than is right. So start at 1 and go right, 2, 3. So then I get to go to do Y, and I go to plug it in, and I go, hey. There's no number to plug in. Well, there's no X where I can plug in my number. Let me put it that way. It's just negative 5. Well, actually, that makes this easy. Negative 5 is all the way down. So 1, negative 5, open circle. 2, negative 5, 3, negative 5. It's just a horizontal line that I'm working with. Okay. And that's all that we're basically going to be doing right there. So then, that covers my piecewise. I'm going to go back a little review a little bit more again. Okay. State the integer and interval notation, graph if needed with these. First problem. Isolate the absolute value before you split it. If you start right away and split it before you do that, before you add the 4 to get it out of there, half your answer is going to be wrong. You're going to lose half the points. Once you get it split, now remember there's going to be 2 of these. X minus 6 is less than 5. Copy what you see. X minus 6 is greater than negative 5. Arrow and value. Got to switch them both. And it's an... Did I just put or in the middle? Hopefully somebody yelled at me when they saw that. This is an and. It's less than. Less than is and. Boing, boing. And that's important because remember, even though it says graph if needed, I'm going to graph both of these. because I know what it should look like. If I finish this and my graph doesn't look like this, something went wrong. I need to fix it. So, add my 6 over. Add my 6 over. And again, even though it doesn't tell me I have to graph, it's a good idea to do it. So what's going on here? X is less than 11. Less than goes left. X is greater than 1. Greater than goes right. And crash in the middle. I'm seeing what I want to see. And now I'm pretty confident my interval notation will be correct. Because again, interval goes left to right, just like everything else seems to. My leftmost point is at 1. My rightmost point is at 11, and I'm good. It's worth the extra minute to do the graph. Just saying. All right, to the next one. 13. Okay, now this time it's already isolated. That's nice. So I just copy what I see for the first one. I notice this time the absolute value is greater than, which is an OR statement. And remember, with OR statements, they go out from each other. And it's funny, I'm sitting here right now and I'm doing the little out thing like y'all can see me. Okay, out. Okay, so my second one, though, remember, don't mess with what's inside the absolute value. Don't mess with that at all. Switch the arrow, switch the sign of the answer. Knock this out. Here we go. So I'm going to subtract 1 over. And now comes the moment of truth. Do you remember, since my last step is to divide by negative 3, what happens? This arrow has got to flip. And fractions are okay. But if I forget the fraction, it's going to mess me up. But I'd notice that when I got up to here. So I'll do it here too. I'm going to minus the 1 over. I'm going to divide by negative 3. And then I'm going to pause here, take a breath for a second. Now again, the importance here of understanding what should be going on, knowing that this is an OR and what the graph should look like. Because if you just go through here and you make an error otherwise, if you get arrows going the same way or they're coming in, you're not going to know the difference. When I go to graph this, x is less than or equal to negative 2/3. Less than goes left. X is greater than or equal to 4/3. Greater than goes right. Awesome. And this is the one with the big interval notation. Forever to the left. Till I get to negative 2/3. Start here. Back up at 4/3. Forever to the right. Okay. All right. Down the home stretch, we're almost done. We got this. To the back. Give an example of a function that has a domain of 0, 5, and a range of 1, 4. We've talked about this before. I'm going to talk about it again here. Take your initial x and y value. Put them together as a coordinate. Take your initial second x and y value. Make them a coordinate. Okay? Now, you can draw other funky stuff, but this is the simplest, most straightforward way of doing it. Plot the 2 points. Connect the dots. I'm done. Okay? Keep it simple. First x, first y. Second x, second y. Plot them, connect them. Boom. All right. Another one. You have a function that has a domain of negative infinity to infinity. Now, when's that ever happened? Oh, yeah, the absolute value functions. And a range of negative infinity to 6. Okay. So negative infinity to 6 means this is as high as it's going to go. Now, that's not my graph. I'm just kind of making myself a line. So this is as high as we're going to go, but I can go down from there, negative infinity up to 6, my domain, forever left, forever right. Just let the range guide you. Know where it starts and ends, and then you just do the opposite from it. That might be easier than the other one. And to wrap it up, describe how the graph of each function is related to the graph h of x. What are the transformations or shifts? There may be one, there may be two. What's that plus 9 mean? It's inside, so left 9. Okay. X minus 2 minus 1. What do these both mean? Right. 2, down, 1. And guess what? You've made it to the end. This is exactly what the quiz is going to look like. Go back, look at it again, grab an extra review. Go back and finish your homework if you haven't done it. But be ready for this, be ready for this, be ready for this, because now that you've basically seen the quiz, there's no reason not to do well.